This is the Thriving Dentist Show with Gary Takas, where we help you develop your ideal dental practice, one that provides personal, professional, and financial satisfaction.
Welcome to another episode of the Thriving Dentist Show. I'm Gary Takas, your podcast co-host. We have a really fun episode for you today. It's titled, Are We About to Experience the Next Boom in Cosmetic Dentistry? I've got some fun information to share with you that has a lot of optimism around it. I think you're going to like this message. Hey, before we get to that, though, a couple announcements to make. First announcement we have is shortly after this episode is published, we have our next Thriving Dentist MBA workshop, our live stream workshop. That's coming up September 19th, 20th, and 21st. That's a Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. It's 9 hours of CE spread out over 3 evenings. We kind of break that down into more bite-sized pieces, spread out over 3 evenings. You get 9 hours of CE credit. And in the Thriving Dentist live stream MBA workshop, I cover the 10 elements of a thriving practice. Each one of those elements can kind of be another building block of developing a thriving practice. We also talk about the 24 systems, how and why a systems-driven practice is so very important. I'd like to invite you to come join us. If you'd like to register for that, it's done in a live stream format where you can attend from the comfort of your home or office. But you can also interact with me because it's live. It's not recorded. It's actually live. And you can ask questions. I run it as a workshop. I've got 10 different exercises, workshop exercises that we complete during those 3 evenings. And the workshop exercises are all about helping you implement the information that's being taught in the workshop. So it's one step closer to getting it implemented in your practice. If you'd like to register, it's very affordable, 9 hours to see, less than $200 of tuition. Come to thrivingdentist.com/MBA and grab a seat. We would love to have you there. They do sell out. Every one of those is sold. This is the last MBA workshop done in 2022. This will be the last one this year. So come join us if you have interest in that. Hey, the second announcement I have is we have a returning guest contributor, Dr. Rupert Monkhouse. He's from Reading in the UK. We really appreciate his wisdom, and he's going to be sharing with you some tips on how to improve the fitting of immediate dentures and also fitting tips in general. I think you're going to really enjoy what Dr. Rupert Monkhouse has to say. I want to give an encouragement for you to follow him over on Instagram. He has a great Instagram account. At Instagram, he's Dentist Rupert. So give him a follow over on Instagram. Let him know that you appreciated his wisdom on the Thriving Dentist Show. With no further ado, here's that wisdom from Dr. Rupert Monkhouse.
Hi there, everyone. My name is Rupert Monkhouse. I previously spoke on the podcast a while ago, so thank you for Gary for inviting me back on to share another top tip. As I say, my name is Rupert. I'm a general dentist from Reading in the UK. And whilst I do general dentistry, I have a particular interest in removable prosthodontics, and I share a lot of it over on my Instagram page, Dentist Rupert. And I also run my own podcast called the Impression Club Live Podcast, which covers all areas of general dentistry. So if you enjoy any of the content that I've put out, be sure to check that out. I've had lots of great guests from the UK and some recently from the US as well. My clinical tip today, following on from the impressions top tip I gave last time, is one that I learned from British prosthodontist Finlay Sutton. It's about helping you improve your fitting of immediate dentures, or even possibly just dentures anyway, regardless of whether there's been any extractions done. So when I fit a denture, particularly an immediate denture though, I like to use a fit checker. This is a silicone. It can even just be your normal light-bodied silicone. It doesn't have to be a specific product, but it can be really handy to place in a small amount of the light-bodied silicone and seat the denture in place. Let that fully seat, and then you can remove that, and you're going to have a reline impression, essentially, within the denture. But what you can look for is any areas of pink acrylic that's shining through, and that's where I'll take a pencil, scribble over that area, so then I can peel off that silicone and I'm left with these little high spots, these little hot spots, if you want to, of pencil mark, which I can then reduce with the straight handpiece. and then I can repeat that process again until ideally what I'm looking for is a nice, smooth, continuous thin layer of silicone. This is particularly handy for immediate dentures because, of course, the patient is numb and they can't feel exactly where it's tight. Since I've started doing this, it's drastically reduced the instances of patients coming back with discomfort to almost never, in all honesty. So I hope you found that useful. And if you did, be sure to check out the rest of my content on Dentist Rupert on Instagram, YouTube, and wherever you get your podcasts.
Hello, everyone. Welcome back to the Thriving Dentist Coaching and Action segment. Thank you, Dr. Rupert Monkhouse from the UK for that wonderful tip. We appreciate you supporting our community and sharing your wisdom with us. Now, let's jump into today's Coaching and Action segment, which is all about, are we about to experience the next boom in cosmetic dentistry? This is Naren, your co-host. Many dentists look back at the early 2000s and believe that that was like the heyday of cosmetic dentistry. In other words, it was a trend that was there and, you know, really was big deal back then, but perhaps has waned since then. And Gary has some information to kind of share with us today that says, you know what, cosmetic dentistry perhaps might have a renaissance. Perhaps there are better days ahead. So Gary, I'm looking forward to this episode.
Yeah, Naren, you know, I happen to be a believer that cosmetic dentistry is about to experience another boom that might even surpass that boom that you recognized as the early 2000s. You know, dentists that have been practicing for a while kind of recognized that the early 2000s, there was a lot of interest in cosmetic dentistry. You know, there was even a TV show, Extreme Makeover. I'm not talking about the home makeover. But yes. Extreme Makeover was an ABC television show where they would choose a patient to have significant medical procedures done. They would have their smile rebuilt. They might have some facial plastic surgery. They might have other types of plastic surgery. They might have hair and makeup done. And it didn't last really long as a show on ABC, but it was very popular for a short period of time. And it generated. Dr. Bill Dorfman was the dentist on Extreme Makeover, but it generated a ton of interest in people wanting to improve their smile because people watch that every week. And one of the procedures they did for every patient on Extreme Makeover was they did cosmetic dentistry. And oftentimes it was transformational in terms of how their appearance were, changed. And as a result, those were generally pretty good times after 9/11, you know, as we got into 2002, 3, 4, and 5, those are generally pretty good economic times. And there was just a lot of interest in cosmetic dentistry. Well, I'm going to suggest that what is coming might even radically increase that interest. And we might look at this as the new heyday of cosmetic dentistry. Let me share what I'm talking about. In a recent survey, we learned that, let's talk about Instagram for just a minute. Instagram is, you know, a social media platform that we're all familiar with. And while and many types of people can be on Instagram, many different generations are on Instagram. For example, I'm very active on Instagram. Some of you may be as well. You may know that the largest group on Instagram are millennials. Millennials is the largest group. And I'm talking about generational groups now. The millennial generation is defined as those people that were born between the years of 1981 to 1996. So people born from 1981 to 1996 represent the millennial generation. And we're told that the largest group of people on Instagram are the millennial generation. By the way, Naren, the millennial generation is actually the largest generational group by population. And that only happened recently. Up until recently, the largest generation were, who would you guess was the largest generation until recently?
Baby boomers.
And then what happened?
I guess they started dying off.
They died. Yeah. Yeah. So baby boomers were the large, but boomers were born from 1946 to 1964. 1946 to 1964. Those are the baby, you know, this is defined by sociologists, you know, that study these kind of things. And that was the largest up until 2021, when the millennial group became the largest because of the fact that the millennials are aging. So that's the largest group population group. But here's the fact I want to share with you, and this is fascinating. 67% of millennials on Instagram have actually taken and photoshopped their smile either in their profile photo or in their posts of themselves on Instagram. 67%. Naren, that's 2 out of 3. If you're mathematically challenged, that's 2 out of 3. That means 2 out of 3 people, millennials, on Instagram have taken the effort to Photoshop their smiles for their profile photos or for their posts on Instagram. And remember, I'm not talking about just using a filter. Using a filter is a pretty easy process. I think my 2-year-old grandson can use a filter, you know, on his photos. But Photoshop is a different game. That requires some advanced, skills, modification skills to modify their smile. What does that tell you? Well, that tells me that they don't like their smile. There's something in it that they don't like. It might be color, it might be crowding, it might be spaces, it might be shape of teeth, but they don't like them. You know, we're in a media society today. There's no denying that media is important to people today, right? Yes. And the media is everywhere. It's on our phones. It's in our social media platforms. It's everywhere. And so people are more tuned into their appearance than they ever have been because of the way we use media so much to communicate with others. And the fact that 2/3 of the millennials don't like their smiles makes me think we're about to experience a coming boom in interest in cosmetic dentistry from a generational group that historically has not been, we've not really paid much attention to when it comes to cosmetic dentistry. Now, some of you have, but I'll bet if you look at the cases you've done in your practice, first of all, we should back up and define cosmetic dentistry. You know, what is cosmetic dentistry? I'm pretty convinced that for some of your patients, we could actually give them a toothbrush, and that could be defined as cosmetic dentistry. Get them to use a toothbrush. Okay, I'm kidding. What is cosmetic? I think of cosmetic dentistry as a lot of things. But what I think is kind of the flagship service we can do with cosmetic dentistry is a lab-fabricated porcelain veneer case. Lab-fabricated porcelain veneers. What we would like to call smile design. You know, that would be 8 or 10 units, typically upper anterior, although it could be lower. That's the term that we call smile design. You know, that's one of the main services in what I would call cosmetic dentistry. I would also think of adult orthodontics as another big branch of cosmetic dentistry services, whether we're using an aligner like Invisalign or maybe a short-term bracket solution like 6-month smiles. I would think of adult orthodontics as another big category of cosmetic dentistry. And I think what we're about to see is that there's going to be a lot of interest in this. There's I think, a lot of baked-in interest in that generational group. And we simply have to let them know what we can do for them. Now, some of you might be thinking, hey, this is great, Gary, but millennials don't have any money. But that could be a possible thought from a listener. Is that correct, Naren?
Absolutely, because they are younger, right? But they are about 24 to 42.
Yeah.
Or 25 to 42. Yeah.
But how would you, so if someone says, well, yeah, Naren, millennials don't have any money, how would you reply to that?
Definitely, some of them are older. So I think the ones who are 35 plus, definitely, I think they are well settled and hopefully they have discretionary income to invest in things like a beautiful smile. How would I respond to the younger people?
The assumption that they don't have money.
Right.
I think you might be surprised.
Right.
I think you might actually be very surprised that they may be better off than you think. In fact, some of them,
maybe they have rich parents. That's right.
Maybe they've inherited, let's face it. Yes. Why did the largest generation change from baby boomers to millennials?
Because they started dying off.
And what happened to their resources?
Get transferred to the next.
They likely generation. Got transferred to the next generation.
Yes.
Yeah. But there's also a lot of very successful millennials, whether it be in tech or just in their work and their life, that sure. frankly have done pretty sure. well. So to assume that any generation doesn't have any money, I think is a false assumption.
Right.
Work on your mindset, Doc. The mindset, use an abundance, a mindset of abundance.
I mean, also don't forget my generation, the one between the baby boomers.
And sure. We're not going to leave you out, mindset. Let's park on mindset for a minute because, if you assume, none of those people have any money, then that's what you're going to get what you're assuming.
Yes.
Instead, make the assumption that they would love to do this. This is something important to them, important investment in their life, and they would love to do it.
Right.
Let them tell you they can't, but don't assume they can't. Make the assumption that they all can. Well, I want to share four specific tips to really grow the cosmetic component of your practice, in particular for that millennial group, but they really extend to all generations. But in particular to the millennial group, because I think we're about to see massive interest from that particular group. Number one, make sure that you have the cosmetic skills on the shelf. That's a term that I've heard used in different continuing education skills, different continuing education programs. But step one, make sure you have the skills on the shelf. And what that basically means is make sure you've participated in the kind of training you want to take to advance your skill sets so that you can confidently present these options to your patients, knowing full well you can deliver what you're presenting. If you don't have the skills on the shelf, what I find with most dentists is they don't present it confidently. And then as a result, it ends up kind of just tailing off because the patient doesn't really get the perception that you can help them with this. So if it's been a while, maybe you've been taking your CE in other areas. Maybe you want to revisit some coursework in the area of cosmetic dentistry. There's some wonderful programs out there, some hands-on programs, some live patient courses. I'm going to strongly recommend my longtime friend, Dr. David Hornbrook. Most of you will recognize the name David Hornbrook. David's a practicing dentist in San Diego. He's not only accredited by the AACD, but he's a fellow of the AACD, was one of the early fellows in AACD, and he's a brilliant educator. He gives a program in Utah at Roseman Dental School where you bring a patient and you bring an assistant, you bring a patient, and you do a 10-unit upper anterior porcelain veneer case. It's just a fabulous course. Dr. Mark Montgomery is his co-director. Dee Dee Reed is one of the instructors. Cannot think of a better place for you to get some great cosmetic continuing education. So number one, make sure you've got your skills on the shelf and advance them as far as you can because it's going to serve you very well. Number two, use whitening as a gateway service. Whitening in your practice. So whitening is a gateway service because when you whiten people's teeth, they are interested in what's next. So imagine some of these millennials in your patient that you present whitening to, whether it be chair side, take-home trays, or maybe an over-the-counter product like Go. I like the UltraDent Go product. Now we whiten their teeth, and when you see them 6 months later for their hygiene appointment, they say, "Doc, I love the color of my teeth, but what about this? What about that? What about this?" So if whitening has kind of been dormant in your practice, it's time to reactivate that. It's time to make that a really important part of your practice. Because whitening, growing your whitening component, will create more interest in cosmetic dentistry. You might be surprised how many veneer cases you do start out as a whitening case or adult orthodontics. How many times we do Invisalign, but it started out as a whitening case. Now they have the color of the teeth that they want, but they want to now have them in the right position. So whitening, get serious about it. And there's no reason why any dental office, any of our listeners couldn't be doing one whitening procedure a day in your practice, one whitening procedure a day. There's no reason. And little more data on this, not every office offers whitening, but for those that do, the average number of cases that they do each month is 1.2 whitening cases a month. 1.2. Woohoo! Did anyone hear my sarcasm on that? And if you're working 4 days a week and you're working 17 days a month, there's no reason why you couldn't do 17 whitening cases a month. That'd be a very realistic goal. And believe me, your practice is different after 6 months. After 6 months, you do one case a month. One case a day. I'm saying if you're a practice that does one case a month,
yeah.
After 6 months, you've got six cases.
Right.
versus if we do 17 a month, Aaron, how many cases do we have after 6 months?
102.
You think a practice might be different if it had 102 people thrilled with the color of their teeth instead of six?
Absolutely.
Absolutely. You bet. So anyway, get serious about growing whitening in your practice. Number three, brush off your show and tell skills. Show and tell skills. And what I mean by that is make sure you're using photography in your practice so that you can, especially after photos, to let people know what's available in your office. You've all heard me talk about the importance of photography. And it seems like photography kind of has a way of, the camera has a way of kind of living in a drawer and not getting pulled out often enough. So make sure that you're revisiting how important it is to get before and afters in your cosmetic. Oftentimes we get the afters, but we forgot to get the befores. And now make sure any photos that we show in your office, we've got patient permission to show those photos. So make sure that you have patient permission to use the photos for patient education and for marketing reasons. But a really cool thing to do is simply build a library that you can do digitally of before and after cases that you can put on a tablet and you can show people, hey, here's how we've helped people improve their smile. The other thing that you can do is you can take, and I would have those you could take yourself, those befores and afters you can take yourself. But I would also encourage you to have a nice selection of after photos that you enlarge and have those as your office artwork after, not before and after, but only after photos. And if you do that, a couple tips on that. I would have those professionally taken because I want to enlarge those and have it taken by a professional photographer. And if you do those, make sure that you've got both men and women represented, but also different ages and different ethnicity represented. So make sure we have patients in different age groups. Make sure we have different ethnic groups represented in those photos. Because basically what we're communicating with this artwork in your office is that a beautiful smile is appropriate for men and women of any age. And if you'd like to see more millennials, make sure that at least some of those photos represent that millennial generation.
That point that Gary just made is so important because what we notice is doesn't matter what marketing we do, unless you are communicating to the patients that you see someone who looks like him or her in terms of age, in terms of skin color, they might assume you might not be a good dentist for them. So
it's subconscious too. It's a subconscious thing. It's not conscious. They don't feel, it's a subconscious thing that they don't see themselves.
Right. So you have to make it a point to show them people like them who are your patients. So pictures with such patients. Beautiful smiles with such patients. So I think it's really important that you do that.
Yeah. Now, tip number four, dial in your marketing. In particular, dial in your organic SEO. Make sure you are found on page one for all the different ways patients would type in cosmetic dentistry or adult orthodontics or whiter teeth or straighter whiter teeth, all the different ways. And if you're curious about, well, I don't even know all the different ways I can say that, you can query Google. So you can query Google, Google and ask Google, what are the 50 most common keywords and phrases in my area when a patient is looking for cosmetic dentistry? And they'll give you the answer. And then make sure your marketing company dials that in your organic SEO, in your website, in your coding of your website, in all the related components, so that when someone types in those terms, you show up on page one. So really, and I know I make it sound easy. I don't want to suggest this is easy, but if you break it down into its pieces, this is very manageable. Okay, so remember, 67% of millennials have Photoshopped their smiles in Instagram. That tells you that they want beautiful smiles, beautiful, healthy smiles. The four tips I suggested is number one, make sure you have the skills on the shelf. Number two, use whitening as a gateway service, great gateway service. Number three, get serious about show and tell in your practice in the form of a digital photo album and also some really nice after photos of patients in your practice. And then number four, dial in your marketing in your practice. By the way, Naren, you didn't ask me to do this, but I'm happy to do so. We've been using your agency, Equa, as our marketing agency for many years, and I recommend it to my clients. If any of you feel like you'd like some help when it comes to marketing and really dialing in cosmetic dentistry, I'd highly recommend Equa, the agency that Naren founded and serves as a CEO for today. We'll put a link in chat. Excuse me. We'll put a link there. It's Equa, E-K-W-A dot M-S-M, stands for Marketing Strategy Meeting, if you'd like to learn more about how Equa can help you. And let's hit a pause here and then go into our Thriving Dentist Q&A segment.
Welcome back to the Thriving Dentist Q&A segment. I really enjoyed this topic, Gary. It's relevant, it's timely, and it's a good way to grow your high value services, right? So when you do cleaning or a filling, you have to do a lot of those to do $10,000 in dentistry. With a cosmetic case, you might only need one or two, and you're done for the day. So it's a wonderful way to, have a profitable practice. So today's topic about, how to grow that and your suggestions were well taken, Gary. Let me jump into four questions I have from the audience. One is, how do I make my practice an attractive choice to millennials?
Great question. So, we talked about that statistic of 2/3 of the millennials on Instagram want to improve their smile. But remember, cosmetic dentistry can extend to any generation. Right. So there's some things we know about millennials. One of the things we know about millennials is they really value technology. They are technology savvy for the most part. And again, whenever we make a broad generalization about an entire generation of people, we run the risk of overgeneralizing. Mm-hmm. There are some millennials that don't care one little hoot about technology, but the majority of millennials really do appreciate technology. So make sure we're showcasing your technology in on your website, in our even in your search engine optimization, because they might be looking for an office that is technology savvy. One of the ways. Another ways, we kind of talked about it in the tips about using show and tell in your practice. Make sure we have photos, and then go back to your website. I think of the website as the hub of all of your marketing. It's the hub. And then really what we want to do is we want to use Google to get people to your hub. So revisit your website. Make sure you've got pictures of people of a millennial generation interspersed throughout your website on the different pages. You don't have to overdo that, but make sure you have some. And make sure they're peppered throughout your website. But also focus on technology. One of the other things we've noticed about millennials is they are often interested in contributing, and they're interested in participating in things that are bigger than themselves. I think sometimes millennials get a bad rap because of some of the more negative characteristics of millennials. But one of the things I've noticed about millennials is they're interested in being part of something bigger than themselves. So if your office does charitable dentistry, whether it be at the local level, the national level, the international level, showcase that on your website. Because when people see that, and I think especially millennials, they realize that you're more than just a local business. You're really changing people's lives on a broader level. And they might think that being a patient in your practice will help you do more of that. And in some way, that might attract them to your practice. What else would you add, Naren?
Yeah, I think I would specifically mention the point that you mentioned, which is pepper in pictures of people of all ages as your patients, as before and after cases, because you want them to find someone that looks like them. So that's age, sex, and skin color. We find this to be one of the key things that stops patients from choosing a practice. Like, you might be excellent, but they might assume you can't relate to them, you can't understand them. So by showing them that you are working with someone like them, I think it goes a long way.
Yeah, absolutely.
Thank you, Gary. Let me ask you the second question. What are the type of keywords and phrases should I focus on Google if I want to grow the cosmetic component of my practice?
Well, remember in that last tip, I talked about dialing in your marketing. You can go to Google and you can query Google. You can ask Google, you know, what are the keywords and phrases that the public uses in my community to look for cosmetic dentistry? It's interesting because it's important to know what the public is using, because the public might not use the same terms that we do. For example, we use the term veneer, like everybody knows what it means. And maybe many people do know what a veneer means relative to dentistry. But there might be a whole group of people who don't know what a veneer is when it comes to dentistry. So we want to use the terms that they use. You know, cosmetic dentistry, aesthetic dentistry. Aesthetic dentistry might be used in some circles and not used in others. So you really want to know what the terms are that the patient uses. And I would also emphasize promoting whitening in your, in your marketing, in your SEO. Because remember, whitening is a gateway service. So if they come into your office interested in whitening, we know they're interested in the appearance of their teeth. So that might be another way to sort of positively filter or positively screen for the kind of patients that we would like to see in your practice. We want to see people that are interested in improving their appearance. And, you know, those terms that they use will be a form of a filter to let them know that this is how we can help them with those desires.
Absolutely. A few other comments I would like to add to your comments, Gary, you know, from a marketing standpoint, from my experience. Of course, you know, keywords like crooked teeth, crowded teeth.
Crowding, spaces.
Spaces.
Color.
Even shape. Like horror stories, cost. I mean, there's all kinds of variations of things people are looking for. You know, redos. Like people, you would be surprised by, you know, what people are looking for. So there might be like a couple of hundred keywords, at least 100 keywords, when you add up everything that you may want to target.
Well, there's also what's called long tail keyword and long tail keyword phrases.
Yes.
An example of that might be, how long do porcelain veneers last? Okay, so right. Someone wants to know, how long do they last?
Exactly.
Well, if they want to know how long they last, what does that mean, Darren?
They are looking for veneers.
They're thinking about it.
Yeah.
They're thinking about it. And so maybe one of the phrases could be, you know, how long do porcelain veneers last?
You know, like, will my veneers stain? I mean, these are common questions people have.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah,
and when they'll find your practice as a match in those the long tail phrases, and then you're the authority that answered their question.
Right. One other point I would like to make is, if you're going to rank highly for anything, you have to make the Google gods happy. So you have to pay attention to, because remember, 90% of the web pages get no traffic, and less than 5% of them get, you know, 95% of the traffic. So you have to pay attention to all the fundamentals of SEO, NAP, Lighthouse Score. We have an episode that Gary and I did. Perhaps we can add a link to it on what those fundamentals are. And we can also, like Gary mentioned, have Lila review your marketing and tell you kind of how are you doing with cosmetic as well as in general. So those are two things we can help you with regards to, you know, this question. I currently have a PPO practice. As a practicing provider, I'm required to follow the plan's veneer fee schedule, which, as you know, is too low, even though it's an uncovered service. Is there a way around this?
This is one of my major complaints against PPO plans. Why in the world should a PPO plan be able to set your fee on an uncovered service? That is ridiculous. But somehow they've been able to do that. Now, I'm not going to suggest you do anything irregular to skirt that because there's simply too much risk that you say, well, you know, we're not even going to submit insurance because this is cosmetic and it's not covered. I would not even think about crossing that line because if you did that and if you were found out and there was a pattern of this, that's called fraud and it could result in the loss of your license. And doctor, it's simply too much of a risk to take. The answer is to drop the PPO plans. Drop them. Get out of them. Because they shouldn't be setting your dental implant fee if they don't provide dental, if implant's not covered. They shouldn't be setting your veneer fee if veneers aren't covered. They shouldn't set you know, adult orthodontic fees if they don't cover adult orthodontics. But somehow they've been able to stick their greedy mitts in those areas and impose ridiculously low fees on you that make no sense. You can't use quality labs with the lousy veneer fee schedule that they have. So the best strategy is over time to successfully drop these PPOs. Now, let's put a link in our show notes. So if you go to thrivingdentist.com and click on the podcast, you can scroll down and find this episode. And in this episode notes, we'll put a link to an episode we did on Thriving Dentist Show called The Six-Step Plan to Successfully Drop PPO Plans. So that really therein lies your answer. And of course, you know, many people won't have insurance. You can offer veneers for people that don't have insurance because then we don't have to play any of those insurance games. But that's a great question. And the best way to do it is you just don't want to get entangled with anything that could result in possible risk for you. So the best thing to do is to tell the PPO plans to go away.
Thank you, Gary. Let me ask you the fourth and final question. Can you suggest a good way to get quality after photos for our cosmetic patients?
Yeah, here's how I want to suggest that. I said earlier in the you know, in the coaching and action segment, this is something you should have done professionally. So here's my suggestion. It's possible that you have a photographer in your practice. In fact, I'm going to say it's not only possible, it's highly likely that you have a photographer in your practice, whether he or she has a studio or just is a, you know, a professional photographer. See if you can find a resource inside your practice to be your photographer. And then what I would do, let's say you find that person, what I would do is schedule a day at some kind of location in your community that would be a good place for a photo shoot. It could be a resort. It could be just different settings you have around town that could be a great place to take these kind of photos. The idea that a resort or a very nice hotel could be a good place for that. So schedule a day. It could be 3 or 4 hours. And I would reserve the meeting room at the hotel. And I would also bring in someone from your practice that had a connection to a hair salon that does hair and makeup. And so now we're going to have your page. Maybe we're going to do this from 10 to 1 on a Saturday morning. Invite a group of patients to show up at different times and then have the photographer. Maybe we do a little bit of hair and makeup before we take these photos. And then we go out into the grounds of the resort and have the photographer take these photos. And out in the grounds, so it doesn't look like a stuffy, you know, studio setting. And that's a great way to do these. And you might be able to invite 12, 15 people over that 3-hour time period. Encourage them to bring a family member or even a pet, and take some photos with their family and their pet and gift them a large format photo, you know, as a gift for thanking them for participating in your photo shoot. You can have some hors d'oeuvres, some nice hors d'oeuvres, cheese and crackers, and, you know, just really have a fun time with it. And, you know, do that once a year, and every year you'll have fresh photos to use on your website, to use in your marketing efforts, and of course, to frame and hang up in your office. And by the way, I like using Costco as a source for developing those photos because you can actually use their frameless photo, the canvas wrap photos, so you don't have to worry about matching any decor, and they're ready to hang. Those photos, you know, in a 2-foot by 3-foot format or even 3-foot by 4-foot format, and Aaron, those used to be very, very expensive to have a 3-foot by 4-foot photo. And now we can do it at Costco and they're very inexpensive. So that's how I would suggest using, you know, setting up something like that. So you have nice after photos in your office. Well, guys, thank you. Thanks for joining us for this fun episode. I hope I've inspired you to think really positively about the possibility that we might be about to be facing a wave of interest in cosmetic dentistry from our millennial patients and millennial people in your community. Well, quick reminder, coming up on September 19th, 20th, and 21st is our next Thriving Dentist MBA live stream workshop. Come join us, 9 hours of CE. Those 9 hours will provide a foundation for you on developing a thriving practice. You know, if you listen to the Thriving Dentist Show, you're going to love that Thriving Dentist MBA workshop. Come join us for that. On that note, let me simply say thank you. Thanks, Naren, for your support. Thanks, Equa, for the support that you provide for my clients on marketing. And I want to thank our listeners. Thanks to all of you for being a loyal listener to The Thriving Dentist Show. Thanks for sharing it with your colleagues. If you haven't done it already, jump on iTunes and write us a review. That helps more dentists find us. On that note, let me simply say thank you for the privilege of your time. And Naren and I look forward to connecting with you on the next Thriving Dentist Show.
When you cry, be sure to dry your eyes, 'cause better days are sure to come. And when you smile, be sure to smile wide, and don't let them know that they have won. And when you walk, walk with pride, don't show the hurt inside, because the pain will soon be gone. When you dream, dream big, as big as the ocean blue. When you dream, it might come true. When you dream, dream big.